The Untamed is a 2019 Chinese drama based off of the novel The Grandmaster of Demonic Cultivation by Mo Jiang Tongzhu. This is the story of Wei Wuxian, a war hero who died a pariah and was then brought back to life to avenge an old friend. Not gonna lie, this is definitely my top three for foreign dramas, and right now it's my absolute favorite Chinese drama. I initially had an entire analysis series planned, but copyright is a thing, and if I want to make content, I gotta play ball, and the game has a lot of rules. One of the best things about this show is the balance of love, tragedy, and humor. Somewhere beneath all the cultivation and high fantasy, because yes, Jianzha is high fantasy, and anyone who disagrees can go soak their heads, there is a very real progression of interpersonal relationships. No choice goes unpunished in this show, and it is heartbreaking when nothing pans out. So, out of all of those sad moments here, I picked 10 that are either more significant than initially thought, or will just straight up rip your heart out. Before we get started, I want to let you know that a lot of these events happen in rapid succession, and therefore, I gotta let you know that it's pretty much mandatory to watch the show before you watch this video. This list has so many spoilers, so please, support the official release on Netflix or on YouTube before watching this video. And so, without further ado, my name is Dr. Cannon, and welcome to your consultation. Number 10. Lan Zichen is forced to leave Cloud Recesses. Let's start with the context. Lan Zichen has every reason to resent Lan Qiren. He doesn't, of course, because he doesn't have a mean bone in his body. Lan Qiren is getting old, and he knows that unless a miracle happens, he's going to die if he gets caught. So why try to run? Why not put the forbidden knowledge in the hands of not only the most capable fighter, but the only one who can protect Lan Guangji when he finds him? Not only that, but the Lan sect will always come back if the leader survives, which is proven time and time again throughout the show. One thing you need to understand about Lan Zichen is that his love language is acts of service. You can see that in the way he's always serving tea, the way he intercedes on Lan Guangji's behalf, and playing music for Nie Mingzhui, probably without ever being asked. Service is loyalty, and loyalty in the cultivation world means obedience. As the sect leader of Lan Gusu, he begs Lan Qiren to run away with the forbidden knowledge. When he refuses, Lan Zichen panics. And this is the first time we've ever seen any kind of strained emotion from him, because he knows exactly what his uncle is about to say. You go, I'll stay, and I'll die. Look at his face! Lan Zichen knows he's right, and he knows his uncle is going to die, but he loves his uncle, and all he can do is show his love and do as he asks. Even though Lan Guangji's return to protect the Lan sect and Lan Qiren's ultimate survival somewhat undermines the emotional weight of this scene, it still marks a dark turn from the show, and it never recovers. Number 9. The destruction of Lotus Pier. Speaking of the death of an entire sect, the death of the Jiang sect is only so low on the list is because it happens very early in the series, and at its core, it really is the loss of innocence part of Jiang Cheng's coming-of-age story. It's a bit excessive, yes, but if this was a different kind of story, or a shonen manga, it would be Jiang Cheng's tragic backstory. And it's easy to blame this disaster on Madame Yu, especially since she didn't just pop Zhao Zhao's blood vessels on sight for messing with one of her kids. The characters, on the other hand, blame Wei Wuxian for sticking his neck out for the Lan sect, but honestly, the Jiang sect's destruction was entirely unavoidable. The whole scene just rips your heart out. When Wang Ling Zhao fires off a signal for backup, Madame Yu realizes she messed up in a fatal way. She takes her kids and tells them to run. Jiang Cheng's best chance is to go and warn his dad and stay away so they can rally the remaining sect members. He knows that his mother would only show him this kind of affection if it's probably the last time he'll ever see her. And they get a chance to warn Zhang Fengyan. The problem is, Madame Yu's the better fighter. If she's struggling, he knows that the only thing he's going to be able to do is delay the inevitable, but he's not gonna let her die alone, and maybe, just maybe, they can give some of the other sect members a chance to escape, and they fail, miserably. All in all, these two are actually really toxic parents. No matter how kind Zhang Fengyan seems, no matter how cruel Madame Yu seems, they're both equally bad. They were often selfish, played favorites to get back at each other, and made their decisions with very little regard for the effect it had on their kids, and believe me, it had an effect. I think that's what Madame Yu realizes when she loses it before she dies. Despite their tumultuous marriage, Madame Yu and Zhang Fengyan were the only thing the other had to rely on, and they die side by side, holding hands, hoping their sacrifice won't be for nothing. Number 8. Lang Wangji lets Wei Wuxian go on Zhongli Pass. To understand where I'm going with this one, let's put this scene in Lang Wangji's perspective. You are Lang Wangji. You are alone and unable to relate to your peers. You were born into a position of power, but you're ultimately powerless to make any decisions on your own, because last time your uncle let anyone make a decision for themselves, your father abandoned you and your mother was locked in a room for the rest of her life. At the age of 16, you meet Wei Wuxian, who effectively turns your world upside down. And you hate him for it at first, but over time you start trusting him. You guys go through hell with each other. You take his advice. He's actually helpful. He's your equal, your friend, and maybe a little more. Until he goes missing for several days after his sect is attacked and both sect leaders are killed. You can't go looking for him because you've got your own destroyed sect and a missing brother to deal with. Months later, you and his brother find him at the end of a trail of bodies. Zhang Cheng doesn't seem to care, and if he does, he's poor at showing it. You are too, because even though you went to look for him, he refuses to tell you what happened and why, even though it's clear that there's something wrong. So you try to help in any way you can, but you fail. Now people are dead, and you are the only thing keeping Wei Wuxian from going up against everything the cultivation world stands for. And you know the cultivation world stands for some pretty terrible shit. You have three options: fight him, go with him, or let him go. If you fight him, you are obligated to kill him. If you turn him in, everyone else is going to kill him. You can't go with him, you'll be abandoning your brother, your sect, and everything you fought so hard to defend until now. And if they say you conspired with him, you're going to die too. So you let him go. It's the only way the both of you will survive. And for the first time since you're 16, you are all alone again. Number 7. Zhao Jingchen commits suicide. Fair warning, this one's actually going to be kind of long because it doesn't have the same context as the other entries. And honestly, I'm just gonna say it. Zhu Yang sucks. He's my least favorite character, especially after what he did to this poor man who didn't do anything to anybody. He is truly one of the innocent victims in this whole story, and I'll talk about Zhu Yang's motives in another video, but let's focus on the task at hand. Around the same time the Jiang sect was attacked, Zhao Jingchen's best friend, Song Lan, and his sect were attacked by Zhu Yang. Zhao Jingchen managed to rescue Song Lan from being tortured and took him to his grandmaster, Boshan Sanren, to be healed. At the time, Song Lan was very emotionally distraught and was, let's just say less than grateful. And in the book, it was so much worse. Despite that, Zhao Jingchen still gives up his eyes and his good standing with his grandmaster for him. Remind you of anyone? With no sect, cast off by his grandmaster, blind with nothing but his sword that seeks out malevolent energy for him, Zhao Jingchen is truly alone. So, of course, he doesn't mind when he's adopted by Ah Qing, a young grifter, and let's be honest, he probably knew the whole time that she wasn't actually blind. While staying in Yi City, they run into a wounded young man who just so happens to be Zhu Yang. Ah Qing instantly knows there's something wrong with him, but Zhao Jingchen is a kind man and won't just abandon someone who needs help. It's honestly the worst coincidence ever. Zhu Yang spends 3 years off and on with them, and during those 3 years, Zhu Yang slowly gets his revenge, not just tricking Zhao Jingchen into systematically killing innocent people by telling them that they're corpse puppets, but never telling them who he truly is. All the while, Zhao Jingchen is a very good friend to him, even indulging his sweet tooth at any chance he gets, just to be nice. Meanwhile, Song Lan has been trying to track him down, mostly just to apologize and make amends for the terrible things he said, after Zhao Jingchen gave up literally everything for him. So imagine Song Lan's shock and horror when he finds Zhu Yang, the man who started this whole debacle in the first place, has just been hanging out with him the whole time. As someone who's killed an entire sect to get back at one person who was already dead, Zhu Yang has no right to call Song Lan on how he treated Zhao Jingchen. But the emotional manipulation still works. Zhu Yang is able to incapacitate Song Lan like he did to everyone else in the city, and this poor girl is terrified. If you read the book, Zhao Jingchen doesn't find out what actually happened until the next day, through Ah Qing, who doesn't really have the heart to tell him that he killed Song Lan. But shit really pops off when Zhao Jingchen discovers that the person he killed was his best friend all along. He has to come to grips with three facts all at once. One, he's killed an entire entire town's worth of innocent people. 2, Song Lan wanted to apologize to him and wanted to make amends. And 3, his closest friend, the person he trusted the most, was his greatest enemy all along. And that would honestly drive anyone to suicide, much less someone with such a vast moral compass. Zhao Jingchen was a good man. He never did anything to anybody and was driven to suicide due to the selfish impulses of one man who didn't realize what he'd done until it affected him personally. His soul was so broken that not even necromancy could put it back together. And we can only hope that one day that Song Lan is able to give him some semblance of peace where he can either pass on or they can be together. Number 6, Jiang Yanli dies. Speaking of people who only wanted to be happy, I could spout off for days why Jiang Yanli isn't as great a sister as Wei Wuxian thinks she is, but that's not why we're here. However, it should go without saying that all Jiang Yanli wanted to do was be happy and make the people she loves happy. She made it abundantly clear that she just wanted her family to be together, and her husband was willing to make that happen because he had enough influence to convince everyone but a handful of people to let him attend Jin Ling's 100-day ceremony. Unfortunately, Fate had other plans. And Fate looks an awful lot like Jin Guangyao. Look at her face here. This is the face of a woman who was just betrayed by her own happiness. Really, we can only imagine how emotionally distraught she must be, essentially losing her brother for the second time and her husband for good. She was always the one who could calm him down. She was the one who always looked for him when he went missing and convinced him to come back home. It's easy to look at this scene and say, what the hell were you thinking? But it's pretty obvious. She was thinking she could bring Wei Wuxian back home. Despite the scene's awkward staging, especially during the moment of her death, you can tell that this is the absolute last straw for every main character. They instantly fall apart without her. Yes, even Long Wanji, who, if you read the book, goes to extreme lengths to protect Wei Wuxian at the last minute, even though he's too far gone to really appreciate it. In the show, Wei Wuxian just gives up. He loses everything, and he almost loses his mind. Also, fuck this guy in particular. Number 5, Jin Jixuan dies. While it's done quite differently in the book, Jin Jixuan's death is, in the show, nothing but a horrible accident. Well, sort of. He's come a long way from when we first met him. He's no longer the peacock who thinks he's better than everyone. Right now, he is really just a man who wants the best for his wife and son. Honestly, I believe in this moment, seeing Wei Wuxian and having a nice, uneventful time with the Yiling Patriarch would have been best for everyone, even the cultivation world at large. Imagine if Jin Ling's 100-day celebration went off without a hitch. Maybe it wouldn't have been perfect, but he would have at least still had parents. That's what sucks so much about this scene. You're forced to think about what could have been. His cousin Jin Jixun is so easily manipulated that all it takes is mere suggestion for him to go out and confront Wei Wuxian with only a hunch to back him up. Jin Guangyao then tells Jin Jixun, oh no, third cousin is going to confront Wei Wuxian, and I have no idea why. Say what you want about this man, but he is still responsible for the deaths and trauma of several, mostly, innocent people. When Wen Yung stabs him in the chest, he doesn't seem to care. All he wants is for Wei Wuxian to reconcile with his wife, because he knows that it would make her happy. I think that he knew all along that Wei Wuxian really had the best intentions, and that his family would try to ruin him. The Jin sect has a habit of completely fucking people over for almost no reason, and honestly, that makes Jin Jixuan better than most of his entire family. Number 4, Wen Qing says goodbye. Wen Qing knows she's going to die. In fact, I'd wager to say she knew that the rest of the Wen sect was living on borrowed time, especially when they were living in hiding. The worst thing about all of this is that each person involved in this scene believes that what happened to Jin Jixuan was their fault. Wen Yung might be the one who killed him, but Wen Qing thinks she's the reason this whole mess started, and Wei Wuxian knows that none of this would have happened if he didn't go to Carp Tower in the first place. Though, let's be real, we all know whose fault it really is. Still, the rest of the Wen sect takes it upon themselves to make things right. Wen Qing knows that Wei Wuxian won't go down without a fight, and she has to sedate him. Wei Wuxian goes through all 5 stages of grief as Wen Qing gently explains to him what she's about to do. She thanks him for everything and expresses her regret that things had to turn out this way, and Wei Wuxian just can't accept it, screaming and resisting the whole time until he falls asleep. Wen Qing deserved better. You know it, I know it, we all know it. In the end, the last of the Wen sect, save for Lan Sizui, are summarily destroyed and made examples of, when, in all honesty, they were just as much victims of the Wen sect as everyone else. And everyone's gonna hate me for this, but I honestly see no difference between this scene and the scene where Vanellope says goodbye to Ralph in Wreck-It Ralph 2. Number 3, Wei Wuxian's death. Let's take note of everything that has happened to lead up to this moment. Wei Wuxian becomes the Yiling Patriarch after turning to demonic cultivation to save his own life. He's been accused of crimes he didn't commit, publicly disgraced, disowned by his family, and the rumors about him are so prolific, he's become the scourge of the entire cultivation society. While it's clearly affected him mentally and emotionally, he doesn't lose hope over it. Up to a certain point, his situation was gradually improving. Then it all comes crashing down. While he's not exactly empathetic in the book, or sympathetic for that matter, The Untamed portrays Wei Wuxian as having a great capacity for empathy, even in the worst of times. His sister's death breaks him, though, and he's willing to go down with the ship. Without Jiang Yanli, there's no hope of restoration, there's no point in winning. And no, I don't think that even if Lan Wangji managed to save him, could they have come back from this, even if they ran away together. So he throws the Yin Tiger Tally into the crowd, and they start tearing each other apart. Something else they'll inevitably blame him for as well. What hurts me the most is that he's shocked when Lan Wangji wants to save him. In the book, he doesn't even remember this moment. He tells him to get lost while the man is confessing his love to him. Jiang Cheng wants to finish the job, but hesitates at the last minute. Lan Wangji and Jiang Cheng are the only people left that he cares about. Everyone else he cares for has nothing but misfortune because of him. So in the end, he decides to make it easy on them and flings himself off the cliff. Both men become bitter and isolated as a result. Number 3, Jiang Cheng finds out the truth. Speaking of Jiang Cheng doing terrible things, I feel the need to editorialize for a little bit. I much prefer the show portrayal of Jiang Cheng over the book version because, man oh man, book Jiang Cheng is basically mommy's little war criminal. Wang Zuocheng has been criticized of his portrayal of Jiang Cheng, citing that his expressions seem a little insincere at times. However, I think it's more because his face is so naturally soft and not a lack of skill, because holy shit, this scene is so well acted by everyone involved. When things calm down after Jing Guangyao's crimes get exposed, Jiang Cheng finds Wei Wuxian and Lan Wangji at the Jiang family shrine and confronts them. I was hoping for a reconciliation, but once Wei Wuxian dropped the Jiang Guanyin, I knew it wasn't going to happen. Jiang Cheng doesn't let it go, of course, ignoring Wei Wuxian's obvious pain and weakness and pressing the issue until the latter loses consciousness and still keeps pushing, forcing Wen Yang to intervene and finally tell him what happened to his golden core. After the death of the Jiang sect, Wei Wuxian was nearly captured in a nearby city. Bereft and grief-stricken, Jiang Cheng made the choice to give Wei Wuxian a better chance to run. In hindsight, his choice makes sense considering Wei Wuxian is a stronger cultivator, and this is going to sound cruel, but everyone likes him better, so it makes sense that someone in that sort of emotional state would make that sort of fool-ass decision. However, when the Wen sect captured him, Wen Zuolu, instead of killing him, crushed his golden core. Upon realizing he'd been rescued, he breaks down, realizing he'll never be able to cultivate again. Horrified by his grief and wanting nothing more than to make it better, Wei Wuxian convinces Wen Qing to change his golden core out for Jiang Cheng. After some convincing, Wen Qing reluctantly agrees and does so under the guise of Boshan Sanren. They never tell him the truth. All at once, Jiang Cheng has to come to terms with the fact that Wei Wuxian's mental and physical deterioration, his determination to save the last of the Wen sect, his turning to demonic cultivation, resulting rebellion against the cultivation society, and ultimate death all started with him, and it destroys him. Everything he's done for the last 16 years has been called into question, and by the end of the show, he still hasn't really come to terms with that, or the fact that Wei Wuxian still wanted to protect him from this truth, even after everything he did. I need some water, I need a minute. While I recover, let's have some honorable mentions. Most of these moments are just small character moments that were too fleeting to really write paragraphs about them. Jiang Cheng tries to protect Wei Wuxian from his own mother. It's probably the first time he ever disobeyed her. Number 2, Jing Guangyao and Nei Huaisong speak amicably for the last time. It sneaks up on you, but once you get to the end of the series, you're like, holy shit, wow, that is the last time they spoke as friends. Number 2, Jiang Yanli getting the news of her brother and killing her husband, because damn, look at that face. That's heartbreaking. And number 4, Jin Ling breaks down on Lotus Pier. As silly as he looks, this kid is literally paying for a crime he didn't commit for the rest of his life. Number 1, Nei Huai Song watches Nei Mingzhuai die. Now, why did I choose this one, you ask? This one was hardly on screen, you might say. Nei Mingzhuai was an asshole, you shout. You're right about all of these things, but that does not make it any less depressing. To grasp the gravity of this, I have to go back before the beginning of the series, and then to the spin-off movie, The Fatal Journey. The Nei brothers are cursed, and not metaphorically either. Nei Mingzhuai's mind is basically being slowly torn apart by the martial spirit in his sword, Basha. Nei Mingzhuai was mostly forced to rely on this spirit because their parents died at a young age, forcing him to take a position as sect leader with no real allies, I believe at the age of 13. Slowly, Nei Mingzhuai's mental state begins to deteriorate, and as such, so does his once close relationship with his brother Nei Huai Song, who's definitely a lover and not a fighter. Then, he makes Jing Guangyao his vice general, mostly despite his cultivators who are acting in a dishonorable way, not really for Jing Guangyao's benefit. While Jing Guangyao can enjoy the higher position, this really just puts an even bigger target on his back, and Nei Mingzhuai doesn't exactly care, but then again, he doesn't seem to care for much these days. Even his brother, who Meng Yao takes a liking to, they're friends for a while. Meng Yao even accompanies Nei Huai Song to the Lonsec lectures, but doesn't stay. I personally think that Nei Mingzhuai intended for Meng Yao to meet Lan Zichen and help him get out of his shell a little, and it works. In the absolute worst way possible. Meng Yao betrays Nei Mingzhuai by killing his best general. Nei Mingzhuai catches him in the act, and he has the audacity to lie about it, even risking his life to prove his innocence. It eventually works because Nei Mingzhuai lets him go. So imagine Nei Mingzhuai's surprise when Meng Yao shows up as a spy for the Wen Sect. Kills several of his old sect members and tortures Nei Mingzhuai until he passes out, only for the man to wake up and be told that Meng Yao was a double agent the whole time. Lan Zichen is one of three people Nei Mingzhuai trusts and pleads Meng Yao's case, and he lets him go a second time. The three become the most highly regarded cultivators of all time, taking stock of Nei Mingzhuai's declining mental health. The newly titled Jing Guangyao and Lan Zichen play healing music to calm him. It doesn't work, because for about 10 years, Jing Guangyao poisons Nei Mingzhuai's mind with music that's designed to sound like the calming score, but does the exact opposite. And to make matters worse, he takes it a step further, teaching Nei Huai Song the same song under the guise of it making him feel better while he's away. Nei Mingzhuai eventually dies via key deviation in front of everyone, while attacking wildly, trying to get at Jing Guangyao, who just watches. In the book, he kills several people, thinking that they were him. What he didn't expect is that Nei Huai Song would try to save him. The last thing Nei Mingzhuai sees is his little brother being comforted by the man who killed him. Shit, I would have come back as a ghost too, just to punch him in the face. Nei Huai Song only finds out by chance what really happened, and several days later, that he's part of the reason his brother died, and he instantly becomes hell-bent on revenge by any means necessary, willingly destroying his sex reputation, his own reputation, Lan Zichen, and Jin Ling in the process. His death had several casualties, 5 different casualties, as a matter of fact, and that's why Nei Mingzhuai's death is number one. So what did you think of this list? Do you agree? Because I certainly have a lot of opinions regarding The Untamed. So I stream every day except Friday and Saturday, and right now we are streaming The Sims 3, but later we will be streaming, once I figure out how to get my PS4 to work, with the encoder again, because everybody knows Elgato can be a piece of shit sometimes. Once I figure out how to get it to work, we will be playing Tales of Vesperia, and I will also be working on a character profile series for Yuri Lowell and Flynn, because, I mean, who doesn't love Yuri Lowell and Flynn? I mean, come on. I will continue to do videos on The Untamed. I hope this video gets past the copyright. Please, Tencent, I am asking you directly, please have mercy on me. Like if you like this video, subscribe if you really liked this video. You can find me on Tumblr, TikTok, Twitter, and Instagram. The lollipops are on your way out, and I will see you in the next video.